My name is Damien Picard. I'm a PhD student at Architecture and System Lab, located at UBO here. And my talk today is about maybe an unfamiliar topic for you, since it's the application of software engineering techniques and methodology for reconfigurable platforms. From debugging, there is a problem from debugging. But it's a bigger view. So let's start by the context. With the increasing complexity of integrated system on chip, with the possibility to integrate more and more resources on these circuits, as described by Moore's law, it's not possible to put a lot of resources on this system. For example, general purpose processor, accelerator, and so on. As a result, this architecture, this target, is more and more difficult to program, and there is difficulty to validate applications. The common technique for validation of this application are very low level and goes through testing and debugging step. And at this level, it's really time consuming and burdensome. So there is a clear need for more productive methodologies with an higher level approach, higher abstraction level approach. So as you all know, software development benefits from really efficient methodology and tools. And so our approach is to apply this methodology and taking benefits of software engineering techniques for validating application for this architecture. So this talk mainly focuses on a key issue, which is the validation of hardware application targeting reconfigurable architecture. And so we have developed a high-level synthesis flow based on Madio, which was presented last year by Loic Laganek at SUCO 8. And so I will show you a multi-level simulation framework from behavioral to the hardware. Then how we interface with third-party tools to plug our tools with mainstream simulation tools and proprietary tools. And I will show you software-like debugging feature in embedded power, the famous property. We advocate for the use of software engineering techniques in order to increase the productivity for this kind of architecture, and benefit from short development cycle, the use of object-oriented models, code generation, and so on. So the talk is organized as follows. I will first give you a short introduction on reconfigurable architecture, just to know what we are talking about. After, I will make you a reminder about the Madio tool, which was presented last year, which uses object-oriented methodology for synthesis on reconfigurable architecture. I will show you the simulation and testing methodology of our tool. We will see a software-like debugging for reconfigurable architecture, or we can use the software concept of prov, breakpoints, watchpoints, and how we embed it in the architecture, in the synthesis, and I will draw some conclusion and some ongoing work. So, a short definition of what is a reconfigurable architecture. A reconfigurable architecture is a runtime programmable architecture based on the hardware reconfiguration. So more or less it's the same principle as the processor. So the functionality of your circuit is not fixed and you can program it. It is mainly used as flexible hardware accelerators for intensive computations. It is based on a lookup table, which has a small memory and used to implement the operators. And it's more oriented general purpose and bring high parallelism and so high performance as compared to a classical processor. However, compared to specific circuits, it's more slow and area power inefficient due to the routing overhead of the architecture. So there is several type of reconfigured platforms. The FPGAs, maybe you already know this kind of architecture. The embedded FPGA, which are sell as core, which are integrated in a system on chip, and the reconfigurable system on chip, which is a complete system with a reconfigurable accelerator. So reconfigurable architecture can be seen as a trade-off between flexibility and performance. So on a scale, you have the processor here, which is programmed with the program, a binary, and process data. The processor is really flexible, and on the other side, you have the integrated application-specific integrated circuit, which is specified with a fixed functionality, and which is really, really efficient, but with absolutely no flexibility. In the middle, you have the reconfigurable architecture. So as you can see, the approach is quite similar to the processor, so the configuration can be seen as a program of the architecture. So a general overview of an EPGR, so how it is organized. So classically, this is, it is a mesh network of lookup tables. So for example, if we want to implement this application, the operator, so the root has a computing resource, and you have the programmable interconnection. So as I said, if you want to implement this, this application, this graph, you place the operation on the lookup table, and after, you repeat it. If you want to modify the functionality, you have just to reconfigure the lookup table, since it's just a memory. So it's a principle, and you can exploit spatial parallelism between the operators. So it's more efficient in terms of performance as compared to processor, and that's why it's used as an accelerator and system on chip. So we target this architecture in our flow since it enables to have a really software approach.
How long does it take to reconfigure such a system?
Yeah, it depends on the architecture actually. It can be some seconds, some milliseconds, it depends on the technology used. And with the advance of the technology, it's more and more fast. But the really long step is the synthesis, as we will see later. That's why it's not so software-like. So let me remind you the MADEO approach, which uses object-oriented methodology for synthesis on reconfigurable architecture. So MADEO was presented last year in SU08 by Loïc Lagadec. The title was MADEO CAD tool for reconfigurable hardware. Or maybe it will ring the bell for you. So MADEO is a generic synthesis framework for reconfigurable architecture. The goal of MADEO is to provide to the designer a tool which is able to evolve with the evolution of reconfigurable architecture and to absorb this, this evolution and even go ahead with a prospection of new architecture and eventually to anticipate the need, the future need. So it's a set of open tools designed with object-oriented principles. It's designed in VisualWorks. And it's strongly based on object models with the common characteristics of reconfigurable architecture defined in an abstract model. So, let me show you the flow of MADEO. So MADEO on the left side, you can specify the application as Smalltalk method, which is then taken as input of the synthesizer and which produces a netlist. So the netlist describes the interconnection of the lookup tables in the architecture, and so the circuit. Then this, this circuit, this netlist, is placed and routed, as I show you on the figure, on the model of the architecture you target. And this architecture, this model, is produced from a description, the domain-specific language, which instantiates an abstract model and produces the concrete model. So here you can see that it's a very flexible approach since you can, with the same application, you can target different architecture. You have just to modify your description and generate a new model. So the interface, the method interface, is the same. So the algorithm implemented in the tools are generic. So an example, you have your method, which is described in Smalltalk. So you produce a data flow graph. So the data flow graph is produced by the synthesizer. And each node represents one operator, and this operator is transformed as a lookup table. So you have some, you have a kind of graphical view of the netlist. So the different modules of this netlist are floor plans, and then plus in root on the model of the architecture. And from this plus in root, you can generate the configuration for the real architecture. Since the model is structured around object principle, the tools are designed with design pattern, visitor, and so on. So you can export this netlist for binary as a binary configuration, or also in other standard format such as hardware instruction language, and so on. It gives really flexibility in, to develop tools to work on this model. You can also benefit from the VisualRox environment and the Smalltalk environment with the inspector, so you can inspect each part of the model and make verification. So Madeo applies software engineering techniques for logic synthesis on reconfigurable architecture. So through modeling and gain genericity through polymorphisms of the model. Now I'm going to describe you a high-level synthesis flow based mainly on this approach. And so I will show you a multi-level simulation from behavioral to hardware, which is used for the testing step of the validation of an application. Or we simulate this application in a model of, a system, or we interface the tool with the third-party tools, and I will show you a software-like debugging feature embedded in the synthesis. So I will first show you the global flow of the tool. So as in Madeo, the input is a Smalltalk method, but this Smalltalk method is translated in an intermediate representation called the high-level CDAG, which represents the control data flow dependency. So it's a control data flow graph. And after the synthesis, this CDFG is mapped on a technology, and we have a low-level CDFG, which is a representation as a graph of the netlist. So this low-level CDFG can be exported, and you can produce in some standard format, such as an hardware description language, to be as input of the backend tools, of manufacturer backend tools, but it can also be as input of the Madeo, Madeo tools to be placed in root. So to, in order to validate the application, we need to simulate it in a system. Since system grows in complexity, there is a lot of interaction to take into account. And it's not sufficient to just simulate the application in itself. So we have developed a component framework to model a system on chip. And it's plugged to a system simulator, and the CDFG is also simulated in a global simulation, and it can produce a waveform or a Gantt diagram at different abstraction levels. So here we have three abstraction levels. We have the simulation of just a Smalltalk method, which is integrated in the system model. So we can benefit from the, for example, VisualRox advantage, debugger, and so on. We have the high-level CDFG, which is simulated by the simulator, and the low-level CDFG, which is also simulated by the simulator. We'll see later how we validate also at the level of the netlist. So the results, the output of the simulation are used for making tests and iterate the testing and debugging step. So let's focus on the CDFG. So the CDFG was first designed to be an interchange format between different tools. It is modeled in Express, which enable to have a formal description of the CDFG, and is taken as input of the Platypus tool, which generates the object model of the CDFG in different environments. So for example, Here you have the CDFG API generated in Java, and you have also the CDFG API generated as Smalltalk. So API is a framework of classes to instantiate this intermediate representation. And a different environment can exchange the CDFG by an export in a step format, as step file. So the application is produced, the CDFG from an application can be produced in different environments by different tools and exports in Mageo, for example. And after, as we saw in the flow, it is used to synthesize the application. So how it looks? So the CDFG, it's a graph, and it enables to represent the application as communicating processes. So the control flow is represented by hierarchical nodes, and the communication are performed through channel. So just to give you how it is represented. So the CDFG is then mapped on a technology, and so we have the low-level CDFG. It is inherited from the CDFG framework and includes additional constructs to represent hardware resources such as flip-flop, registers, and you can describe also finite-state machine, things related to hardware synthesis. This low-level CDFG is taken as input of the synthesis tool. So, how we keep the link between the CDFG after synthesis? So, for example, if we simulate the low-level CDFG, you might want to retrieve what the signal corresponding in the high-level description, so for example, a variable. So here, it's a representation of a variable, and after a synthesis, it's more or less how it looks in hardware after a synthesis. So, how to find back the value? We do it with a simple structure, we call it a mapper, which keeps a link in a dictionary of association. The link between the high-level variable and the data, since a variable is implemented as a composite data in the hardware, this mapper gives the possibility to find back and to rebuild the variable from the low-level signal. So that's why we have this specification, big endian and little endian, and there is another characteristics to know. So you have the link between the different abstraction level, and you can efficiently perform verification, testing, and also for debugging. So this the mapper is really useful for simulation. So the simulation take as input is at 3 level, as I said. I take as input a behavioral specification of the application in a Smalltalk language, so it's just a method, and it's directly executed by the Smalltalk virtual machine. Except that you can add to the to this method some specific constructs, specific message to communicate with the simulator and to generate events. The high-level CDFG is automatically generated from the Smalltalk code and is also simulated. Here, each node is simulated with the same API of the simulator. And you have the low-level CDFG, which corresponds to a hardware simulation, as we will see. So let's see how we model the system. So the component framework is based on a component approach, and it enables to hierarchically compose different modules of a system, so you gain in modularity and reusability. And so the component characteristic is that, as you can see on the figure, you declare an interface, which are ports, and this interface are linked by a channel with different semantics. And in these components, the activities are processes, and these processes communicate through channels. So, it's a very simple class hierarchy. So, the components are redefined by the user to specify the element of the system. And here we have, for example, two types of connection, which is FIFO and a blocking channel. So this component framework inherit from the simulation framework, which is mainly based on the Blue Book event-driven simulation kernel. And we have adapted this API to be able to make the system simulation. So here the user model is an extension of this framework. So for example, a case study, we have partially modeled a system on chip. So we have modeled a CPU, the global memory, the reconfigurable accelerator connected to local memory, and access controller which transfers the packets between the main memory and the local memory of the reconfigurable accelerators through a bus, which is also modeled. And here you have the application which is simulated on the component reconfigurable accelerator. So this simulation enabled to produce interaction diagram, so you can check all the interaction between each element of the system, the CPU, the DMA, the memory, and the bus. So here you have, for example, the request and the message send. And also generate a Gantt diagram, which is give precisely all the activities that you log with the simulator API in the model. So you have the activity on the bus, the activity of the application, the reception, data computation, and data set. So, another level of simulation is low-level CDFG simulation, which corresponds to the hardware simulation. So it's a cycle-accurate simulation, meaning that the precision is one clock cycle. So the stimuli on the low-level CDFG interface, which are a collection of signal, are defined in a method of the accelerator components and correspond to the interface between the system activities and the circuits, the application map on the reconfigurable architecture. So the values are traced the same way as before, and the signal traced are set through a specific interface with the representation of the graph. So you select it, and you can associate, you can listen what happened on this trace. And it generates waveforms and graphics. So for example, here you have the beginning and the stop and the end of the execution with the signal start-stop, which is set at 1 here and here. You can have the address or the data right on the output channel of the application, the loop indices, and so on. So these values are recorded in a collection, and at each cycle the signal has a value. So it can be used to perform tests, for example, to test this value against expected results at one given cycle through SUNIT methods. SUNIT is also not used only for testing the application, but also for testing the synthesis tools. So for example, after an evolution, or to take into account a new target, so you have your unit test when you check if your netlist is generated, or you can also check two results of a simulation, for example, the content of two memories to see if the correct results are produced. So for example, on test two, you have two synthesis cases for different families of device. So, I show you how we simulate at three abstraction levels, the small dot method, the high level CDFG and the low level CDFG. But also very important to be able to plug these tools and the results of the synthesis tool in mainstream tools, so third party tools. For example, the manufacturer tools or the simulation model library, the simulation library of the manufacturer. So I'm going to show you how we interface the output of this tool to third-party tools. So in a classical hardware design flow, the application, the hardware application, is simulated at low level and is set in a wrapper. So, another engineer would write this wrapper by hand in hardware description language, which takes a lot of time. It's really time consuming, error prone, and can be very complicated depending on the application. And furthermore, it's done at very low abstraction level and very specific. So if you need to test another application, you have to update or to perform deep update in your wrapper. So in order to increase the productivity, we propose in our framework to script and to generate automatically the hardware description of this wrapper from our tool. So for this, as I told you, the interaction between the system and the application are defined in a method of the component model. So this method is a set of stimuli. And so the stimuli are set as dependencies, classical dependencies in Smalltalk, on signal. So you have actions which are performed in function when the signal has changed. So it's possible in this standalone script to script execution scenario through the dependencies, and it avoids all the hardware details since it's in the model, and you don't have directly to manage this. The set of interaction between the system and the application are defined by the dependencies, and as a comparison with the software object world, it can be seen as a mock object in order to test the application. So from this mock object, we generate the hardware wrapper, so as you can see on the floor. So the simulation script is taken as input of the multi-level simulator, which is a Smalltalk method, and the wrapper is generated and taken as input of the model sim tools, which is a mainstream simulation tools with the netlist. So an example of how to set a dependency. So for example, to stop the simulation, a dependency can be set on the signal DOM. So if the signal DOM is set to 1, the simulator stops, or triggering another signal on change or another one. For example, on acknowledgement of the access controller, if it's set to 1, you can force another request to 0 after 10 cycles. So the action field, you can also set a collection of actions to perform multiple actions. So here it's an equivalent code in Verilog. So how to stop the simulation, how to trigger a signal change. So okay, it looks shorter here, but the complete file is really bigger since you have to take into account the signal declarations, the module declarations, the instantiation, interconnections, and other low-level details. So we have seen that the Smalltalk coding plus the automated generation enable to save 50% of the designer's coding effort. So we have 50% less line, number of lines. So an example of a simulation. So here, for example, you have a variable which corresponds to the data right in memory. And the link is kept between the netlist, the low-level CDG, and the high-level CDG, with the same principle as the mapper. So it's really useful when you need to debug your application at this level, since you can find back the corresponding variable to a signals. So now let me show you how we insert debugging software-like debugging feature in hardware. So, as we saw, the multi-level simulation enables to test the application at any flow stage, and we have used SUnit. We used SUnit testing, a modeling approach with modeling of the system and modeling of the application as a CDFG, and we are able to interface these tools with third-party tools. But once validation has failed, it happens, it's time for debugging. So, something you really know well. So, the VisualWorks debugger, for example, you are able to set a breakpoint, You have different features, so you can dive in message, you can step by step to execution, resume, stop, restart. And you have also a global vision of the execution context, so with the message tag, the stack, the local variable, and you can benefit from the inspector. So all these features are very efficient and enable to the software developer to be very fast, to have very short cycle with edit, compile, run, debug, and short iterative cycle. So all these features does not exist in hardware. As I said before, for example, the synthesis is very longer than only compilation. So there is no symbolic debugging, no execution stack. Common hardware debugging methodology for reconfigurable architecture are based on software solution and hardware solution with more, more or less complexity and performance. So you have ModelSim, as we saw, which is a simulation tools. You have SystemC, which enables to model your system on chip as a set of C++ classes. But you have the drawback of C++, which can be very complicated. And you have on the hardware side embedded logic analyzer, which is the instrumentation of your design, so you can get the value of some signals, which is removed after. So here we are looking for a trade-off between performance and complexity on both sides. So we use reconfigurable circuits since it's very close to software approach, very close to processor. And it's like a bridge between the software and the hardware world. And we exploit the reconfigurability because it enables to reuse the circuits, so we can insert, for example, debugging support in it. It's not definitive, as a contrary of integrated circuits. And so the cycle is more or less similar to a software cycle, edit, compile, run. Here we have edit, synthesize, configure, and run. Or configure can be run. So, synthesis is really time-consuming. So, the solution we have is to, as I said, insert the debugging feature in the application and to run it in hardware in order to gain in performance. So, the probe and session can be done at the three levels in the Smalltalk method. So, in this case, you debug in your classical environment as a classical object application. In your high-level CDFG, and also can be inserted in the low-level CDFG to be embedded in the netlist. So, this probe, we reuse the concept of software probes, so watch points, breakpoints, so which was really common, and we add in hardware controllability over hardware execution in order to get the same capabilities as, for example, the VisualWorks debugger, with the possibility to resume, to step-by-step the application, and to explore the context. So we benefit from the reconfigurability, since all this debugging support is inserted automatically in the application, so the probe plus the controller, and remove once the design is validated. So it's really easy with reconfigurable architecture. And all these tasks are automated by the flow. So we have an interface to set the breakpoint, which is similar to the previous one. So here you have, for example, the representation of the low-level CDFG. And we set breakpoints here with condition. For example, if this signal is equal to 1, the execution will be free, will be frozen. So all the execution is controlled by the debugger. So here is a representation of the CDFG in the simulator. So we insert, after synthesis, is a representation of a low-level CDFG. This CDFG is connected to a schedule controller, which just control the sequencing of the operation. So this part is important because it's the place where we insert the debugger feature in order to control the execution. So on the low high-level CDFG side, we insert breakpoint, and this breakpoint has connected to the simulator, which gives to the designer a control interface. And so we want to do the same on the hardware side. So the breakpoints are inserted in the low-level CDFG and synthesized, and connected to a debugging controller, which is inserted in the controller of the application, and which provide a control interface similar to the one in the software part. So here, a detailed vision of the breakpoint. So the red operators are the breakpoint. They are connected to the output of an operator, for example. So as you can see, you can select a comparison operator, so equal, superior, inferior, and a value to compare. When this breakpoint is triggered, it sends a signal to the debugging controller, which frees the local controller, which sequences the execution. So these breakpoints are configurable, and which enable to have a kind of software approach to debugging hardware. Since we don't want to resynthesize each time we want to insert breakpoints in the application, the pool of probe signal is static, but each breakpoint can be enabled or disabled. So it gives the possibility to the designer to speculate on the execution and to disable some breakpoints or enable it and restart the execution to verify some condition. So it's very useful, and in a sense you can backtrack execution. So it's not exactly like Smalltalk when you go back in the message and so on. You have to restart the execution, but in the end you get something almost similar. The breakpoints are configured by some word which contains the operator selection, the activation status, and the arguments. This activation status can be read back in a debug mode in order to see which breakpoint was activated and so on, to make analysis. So here it's a watch point, which is a lot more simpler than a breakpoint. It's just to hardwire a signal to the top interface in order to be able to observe it, for example, in simulation or through a specific interface, and it's done automatically. Which is quite a tedious task to do at the hardware level. So here an example. So the yellow circle shows a probe which is activated, and as you can see, the signal stays stable on this period, so the execution is frozen. And after we send the resume signal to the controller debugger, and the application is going on. So it's just an example of how we can control the execution when a breakpoint is triggered. So I come to the conclusion. I show you a methodology for validating application targeting reconfigurable architecture with the use of multi-level simulation, platform modeling, and it's a high-level synthesis framework. So we start from a high-level specification, here a Smalltalk framework. We benefit from the software expertise for hardware design. It is the goal of these tools, and in order to increase the productivity of hardware engineers. So some ongoing works with a dynamic insertion of breakpoints into the application by exploiting the dynamic reconfiguration capabilities of some architecture to embed some assertion in the design to use some S-unit testing methodology. And we have to finish the interfacing of the synthesized application with the high-level tools, in order to have a clear interface with the hardware running. Thank you. If you have any questions. Yeah, it's a subset. It's data flow oriented. So you have some restriction on the control structure, since it's not easy to synthesize. You have restriction of variable you can use. You have to use local variables, and it's a subset of Smalltalk. You cannot really use all the Smalltalk you want.
Domain-specific language.
Yeah. Yes?
How many guys approved?
We didn't finish the evaluation of synthesis. but it's quite an overhead.
Yeah,
especially because of the complexity of breakpoints. Since, in a sense, you have an operator, a comparison operator, right. So...
Yeah, you should show less than equal, those are kind of simple problems.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, independent of the operator.
Right. But, oh, but do you synthesize the specific proof for the given breakpoint condition, or do you have a generic proof that you somehow configure?
The prob is generic, so you have a set of operators,
okay.
But you can specialize it, it's also possible.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. So it's always a matter of trade-off. But since it's a reconfigurable architecture, so...
Well, you said reconfigurable architecture has to be absolutely sure. You're talking about FPGA, right? Is this all FPGA?
For example, yeah, but not only FPGA. You have some different flavors with different granularity.
Oh, right.
But we in this work we target FPGA, fragment FPGA. We have made some tests on the M2000, some embedded FPGA.
Yeah, okay.
So your debugging proofs is using resources on the gate array.
Yep.
So the gate array cannot be exploited up to 100% if you're still applying some props.
Exactly. Yes, of course. Ah, nothing is free.
No, absolutely. And you could just put the proofs on the wires you want to monitor, for example.
Yeah.
So you don't have to